I got to know Stan in three capacities, as a student, as a colleague, and as a friend. As a student, when I was a young 20-year-old something, I learned a host of new words, along with other people, other my friends in the HTC group, words like epistemology, historiography, critical thinking, semi-autonomy, Popper, Lakatos, research project, scientific revolution. These were the lingua Andersonania of hanging out with Stan and going to his seminars. But the point wasn't that these were just his sort of favorite topics, but that he insisted on developing a sort of a critical relationship to both what we do as historians, as intellectuals, but also in how we relate to architecture and challenging architecture itself to, in some sense, to develop its own sort of research project. He believed very strongly in the sort of relationship between sort of the history world and the buildable world. And that, I think, relationship is felt very strongly in his students who carry that forth today. And he also, you know, brought that together with a particular sense of social charm. There were the Thursday afternoon sherry hours, which are now illegal at MIT. We would gather in his office, and we would, Lakatos was always easier with a glass of sherry. And then we would all go to Bertucci's, and we went to Bertucci's so many times that they created the HTC pizza. And I'm not sure exactly anymore. I think it was mushrooms, sausages, and peppers. It went through some variations. But he had an uncanny capacity to bring people together and to create bonds. When I became a colleague of his here in MIT, I discovered another part of him, because when you're a student, you don't really know your professors really all that well, or you know it in a particular way. And I saw him now as a colleague when he was department head, and I learned not only of his great faith in the institution at MIT, but of his deep commitment and passion to the core principle of education as a cultural reality. But with the same way that he could light up a room with his wonderful smile and grace, he could stare down the curmudgeonest of faculty with a tilt of his head and a steely glaze, which was also something to learn. Once he stepped down as department head, I got to know him more as a friend. We had several lunches together. We'd go out to often be invited to Nancy and Stan's house. got a taste of the softer side of Stan. His wonderful building that he made, his house in Maine. We went up there and visited that, truly spectacular. And a stronger sense also of his deep relationship to his friends, to Batuz, to Hank Millen, and to his colleagues, and to his family. And the last time I saw him ambulatory before he became ill was sometime in June, and we were, I need my prop. And we were cleaning up our offices because they were gonna do some restoration. And I had my oppositions there. And I said, well, you know, Stan, I have my oppositions. And somehow, opposition number one went missing. And we talked about this and that and whatever it is. And then we left. And then next day, he went down to Maine. And I came in my office. And there on my desk was oppositions number one. And at first, I thought, oh, maybe I found it. then I opened it up. And there's still an inscription that said, "Formwork, with appreciation for your collegiality and friendship, Stan." Well, Stan, it was really your collegiality and your friendship that set the tone for HTC, and I thank you very much.
big jump.
Look at mine, look at mine.
That's a good one.
So we don't try to skip it?
No, that's the wrong shape for skipping. It's not flat enough.
Let's see.
It has to be flat and round.
Get it sideline.
Well, watch Marek. He's going to try it. Marek, okay, you try it. Ah!
The whole house sort of blend into the landscape, into the natural landscape in so many interesting ways, but they have sort of sculptural appeal as well. If you take the decks and all the other elements, the paneling that's sort of by the windows and everything, there's a sort of unity to it.
These are actually not quite up to date. SketchUp model have been doing things. But here's the foundation plan for this. And a floor framing plan for it. I have not drawn the roof framing plan because in the SketchUp model we were studying the roofs.
Is it just like a drag tool where you can go right, like to look down straight over top of it, where you just drag it or rotate it vertically? Oh yeah, look at this.
Here's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16.
Well, that's nice, Carlina, to put him back with his friends. And family. Lily.
Put the flowers besides them. Put the flowers besides them. Put the flowers besides them.
I'm holding them in a precise way so I can keep the leaf and the flower together.
Top of the roof there, where it's actually changing, there are different planes. It almost takes a feeling of like one plane that's just like smaller and bigger shingles. I mean, there's just a way it kind of all seems, it contributes to the flatness is what I'm saying, but that starts to look flat because everything else does.
Thank you.
That's really wonderful.
Okay.
Mission accomplished.
There's that personalization of the house. The house has many cycles. It has a daily cycle, weekly cycle, seasonal cycle, annual cycle, cycle of people growing older, cycles of birth and death. You know, so that it's a very complex interior to a house, but you don't turn all that to the exterior. It may be reflected in the interior of the house because that's where the life is going on. But to the exterior, you show decorum, simplicity.
And how was the experience of building something and then in the end you see it, how it is?
In this case, it was satisfying.
Satisfying.
We must give thanks for that beautiful video. The first paragraph of these notes is taken from the last email that I was able to send to Stanford. It starts out, "I remember well sitting on the steps of Cranbrook. Was it 1964 or 65? Having a conversation with you that changed my life, because it led to so many others that have continued since. Through the great experiences of MIT, finding our way through the late 60s and 70s, carrying on through decades of exchange to the marvelous discoveries last May of your house in Maine, and all that it embodies about architecture, about caring decisions, about commitment, craft, and the harboring of friendships. To continue now, addressing the Stanford who is still among us. Remembering your love there for sunsets glowing across the bay, the beach, the rocks on which your house balances so lightly, and into the waiting chairs of your porch. As reawakened my own watch over the days, completing their cycle on the western edge of the continent, beyond what we call Clarity Rock, in similar shades of glory. It brings to mind the steadfastness of your being. For decades of your commitment to paying attention to moments and details embedded within larger patterns of thought has provoked very many others to seek the full reality of what they examine, to avoid the snares of categorization. For this in itself, you deserve to be revered. I also remember well those days in Paris in the early 70s, exploring a broader understanding of streets and their urban potential. We were mapping with a cadre of students from the Grunsfeld program, not just the solids and voids of conventional urban design analysis, but the levels of social access and interaction that streets and ground level spaces together could afford. The windowed shops and public gathering spaces that give an underlying rhythm to the activities of an urban place, bound together by pedestrian access. You continue to explore such intersections between form and human experience through your editing and writing in streets, charting a theoretical path for understanding how physical structures may and do both suggest and limit the nature of human activities and enter into our lives in multiple ways. In your work with CASE and the Institute of Architecture and Urban Studies, as well as at MIT, you were consistent in your support for understanding, for efforts at understanding the sources and implications of form, yet always dedicated to broadening considerations and finding intellectual resources in a more inclusive way. Craft and respect for materials were also integral to the search and embodied in that which you designed, scrupulously attentive to details in the making, with parts retaining identity as they were placed together, revealing the deliberate caring hands and minds that made them. In the concluding passage of your comprehensive study of Peter Behrens, this was symbolized by a carpenter's plane depicted in Durer's engraving titled Melancholia I, which, as you noted, could hardly be more lovingly expressive of the materials from which it is made, the way in which it was made, of its interaction with both the materials to be shaped and the hand that shapes. To recognize acute observation as a way of building culture and to place works within a landscape of intentions that joins thought to their kin was not just a habit of your mind, but a program to reinforce and advance understanding. That program is now institutionalized in the HGC doctoral studies, to which you gave such formative and decisive leadership and support. You were steadily considerate of what others would bring for sharing, quietly urging further thought, prompting with questions, suggesting paths of exploration, adding thoughts that would coalesce new insights, moving forward. Yours was a mind with a depth of generosity that gave close attention to all that could be nourishing, finding ways to bring it within the realm of your ever-expanding intellectual reach. We shall all so miss the encompassing wisdom that you brought among us. There's a sentence which you set gently into your writings about Eladia Dieste's beautiful principled explorations of vaulted brick architecture. Sentences. We do not want to remain at the surface of a matter when it can be probed profoundly. That sentence might suitably stand for the depth of Stanford Anderson's own search for enlightening care and comprehension within all of his works and within the friendships he nurtured among us. May it be a lasting lantern for us all. Thank you, Stan. Thank you, Nancy. You've been such a great part of Stan's creative way of being.
My name is Hong Bin Kang. I'm from Seoul. I was Stan's very first student at HTC. I joined the program even before it formally opened. And I had the honor of becoming the first PhD from the HTC program. Stan even granted me this honor of sharing his office space, 4209, as I remember. It's a long time before the HTC pizza, very few. And along with this really well-stocked bookshelves. I guess I was at the time a really big-headed young man wanting to pursue an advanced study in historiography and urbanism and finding no place to go. I felt the existing doctoral programs either too confined in scope or lacking the critical perspective. I found this HTC. Stan graciously took me in, and it was like a Canaan to me, flowing with milk and honey. So I was allowed to continue my study. Happy times under the guidance of Stan. In the program, throughout this journey in the program, Stan was like a shepherd to me. He was a loving one, a shepherd. He guided, but not led. He was very supportive, critical at the same time, protective, but never pampering. Stan care, in my case, I'm sure others' cases as well, but was not confined within HTC. I cannot forget many places and many times he took me to the wider world. Chile townhouse at Grosvenor place in London, where we went together to attend AA's Karl Popper seminar, and then the quaint inn at Île Saint-Louis in Paris, with very squeaky staircase, as I recall. Wellesley seminar on the end of, turn of the century, Vienna. Fantastic meal at the Mrs. Wilkes' Southern Cooking in Savannah, Georgia. I can go on and on. Nearly 40 years have passed since I left Stan in HTC. The happy days I spent under the tutelage of Stan have long since passed, of course, and the harsh realities of the field I have worked in since returning home bear very little resemblance to inspiring and rich intellectual universe of then and there. In retrospect, however, I realize those days remain alive, like the tree rings inside an old tree trunk. The legacies of Stan and HTC have continued to inform my thoughts and my practices in running the City of Seoul, in running the museum now. Belated and remorsefully, I realized that I haven't really had the time to really express how I owe to Stan for all the things he did to me when it was still possible. Looks like I have taken for granted, for some reason, that Stan would be around forever. So, thank you, Stan. Your absence draws me to realize how big a place you have had in me, and I'm sure in the lives of many other people. And I shall miss you for a long time, but also I do know that you will live on in my thoughts, in my memories, in my heart. Goodbye, Stan.
Hi, I'm Mark Anderson, Stan's nephew, and I'm representing our family here today, my brother Peter and my sister Kristen, who are here today with us. And I'm also representing my parents, Charles Anderson, who is Stan's only sibling, and my mother Margie. And they're very sorry that they were unable to travel to be here with us today. During the last year, especially, our family has had a lot of opportunity to look through photographs and be thinking about Stan's role in our family. And we've put together a selection of photographs that you will see cycling on the wall during the reception. For Peter, Christy, and me, Stanford has always been Uncle Stan. He's always been a very important part of our family life and our family lore. In the early 1950s, Uncle Stan first worked in Boston, where my parents were living, and he was visiting while my father studied at Harvard for his PhD. And at that time, Stan worked in a manufactured housing plant in the suburbs of Boston. He drove a very cool, beat-up Studebaker convertible that his own father very much disapproved of, and famously worried my parents when he drove around blithely in his convertible during the great Boston hurricane of 1954. Later, my family was living in Palo Alto, and I was born there at the time that Stan was studying at Berkeley, and Stan was my godfather at my baptism. Stan was always a very kind of exotic and inspiring presence in our family, and was always kind of bringing some adventurous inspiration about the larger world into our lives. Certainly, Stan's influence was a very major influence on his family, and within my generation of the family, we have two architects, one director of international education at the university, and three historians, Teague and Martina and Kimberly. So certainly, he was an inspiration and an influence. I'm reminded by Professor Kong's comments that as much as he was always an inspiration, he was also sometimes intimidating and never pampering as well. Stan's particular point of view as an architect and historian was certainly shaped by his family as well, and the generations of Norwegian-American immigrants from which he descended. Our father and Uncle Stan were both born in the small city of Redwood Falls, Minnesota, where their father had established a granite works in the late 20s and in the early 1930s. And that granite works unfortunately collapsed financially during the Great Depression, right about the time that Stan was born. His father, Carl Anderson, was the second son of a homesteading farm family in Minnesota. And Stan's father had developed his trade, not being able to go into the family farm, he developed his trade as a skilled stone cutter and a designer and craftsman of granite monuments. This remained his trade throughout his life. Stan's mother also came from a homesteading farm family, only a few miles away from her husband's farm, and they were part of a very small, tight-knit community of Scandinavian immigrants. Together, Stan's parents built a hardscrabble life, Carl working as an independent granite worker, Dora working as a mother and sometimes running a secondhand store, and working as a clerk at JCPenney's. They lived first in eastern Minnesota in the small town of Ortonville until Stan was about 10 years old. During World War II, when travel was very difficult, Dora's health forced the family to gather black market gasoline sufficient to drive a truck across South Dakota into the Black Hills to the town of Sturgis, which is the city of Wild Bill Hickok and Calamity Jane, now famously known for its wild rodeos and motorcycle events. It was here that the family started again, and my father and Stan grew up and graduated from high school. Their parents struggled during a difficult era in American history, and they never owned a home of their own. But they did set their sights very high for their family, and their two sons went on to obtain influential careers as professors. Among the influences carried forth from this life in Minnesota and South Dakota was a dedication to the significance of craft and working with material. While Stan is, of course, best known for his work as a scholar, his smaller but remarkable body of work as a practicing architect also has great significance for many of us. I had the opportunity to live with Stan and Nancy at Commercial Wharf in the early 1980s and to work on, as a carpenter, on the first home that they built in the rafters of Commercial Wharf. I worked with a number of former students of MIT and a faculty, another faculty member of MIT, Trimi Tremolio, on that project. Along with this opportunity to work, it was my own work with my father in carpentry and with Stan in these projects that had a very profound influence on my own work as an architect. And certainly in the work that Peter and I do as architects, there's no architect so profoundly significant in the way that we think about our own design work. Stan's two projects at Commercial Wharf and his latest work that he and Nancy built in Maine are quite amazing projects from my own point of view. And I think, like many of you, I've sat in each of these projects a number of times and pondered over a lot of the somewhat hard to understand details. I was wondering about this decision or that, intrigued, sometimes amused, and delighted at the sort of open-hearted personality of so many deeply considered details that come together as idiosyncratic, deeply felt, richly crafted compositions. So he's been a very significant influence on so many of us. Thank you.
Down on the beach, the waves leave their marks in the sands. Sometimes the long sweeping marks of high forceful waves, sometimes little scallops made by quiet ripples washing gently on the shore. Sandpipers, ducks, gulls, the deer and raccoons come and leave their tracks in the soft sand. And the wind leaves theirs among the grasses. Marks that tell stories of the day and night. But the stones along the water's edge tell stories of thousands of years gone by. Red stones and blue, greens, browns, yellows and grays, in combinations that defy description. Stones that have traveled far to be here. Stones that have many miles to travel ahead. Stones that hold true records of prehistoric times. Striped stones that reveal the layers of minerals which formed the rock from which they were chipped by the winds, the waters, the heat, and the frost. Now and then, there is one with ripples on its surface, or raindrop prints made at its hour of formation, and bits of coral that developed in warm salt water 300,000 years ago. Stones, tumbled by the winds, rubbed by the sands, washed by the waters, ever so slowly turning into sand. And the winds, the sands, and the waters sculpture some into beautiful forms, and working together etch wondrous designs on others. And the years go by, as each stone travels ever toward the sea. It may move with extreme slowness, or rest for ages in the field or lake. It matters not, for nature has ample time on which to draw. But always, that which it has created must return to be created anew. For that is the law of the universe.
My name is David Friedman. I was a colleague of Stan's in the history theory section for well more than a decade. And I'd like to describe what I saw in that period as Stan's greatest achievement. And if it's a little, sounds a little impersonal, I hope somewhere underneath you'll understand my great appreciation for what he did and for him. So Stan was the chairman of HTC, we finally call it History Theory Criticism, for between 74 and 91. These were the formative years of this program, and it is Stan alone who's responsible for the direction it took. For many of those years, he was the only tenured member and also the only permanent presence. He got great people as visitors, but it was Stan that took responsibility for the students and for the curriculum. He ran the program with very limited means. Money for the visitors was eked out of the salary of the budget for Hank Millen and Wayne Anderson, who were the other two founders of the HTC program, who had gone off to do other things. Student fellowships were scarce. Still, we had a huge application pool. They came to study with Stan. The heart of HTC that Stan created was the methods class, and it was mostly taught by him. In his hand, the course was not historiography. This is the common form of methods classes in art history programs. That is, it's a study of the history of art history and architectural history. Stan's method class was epistemology, as you heard so beautifully from Mark. It read broadly, and it sought ways that could teach something about how you do history and how you can talk about architectural production. Stan's emphasis on method allowed him to advise PhD projects in material very far from his own specialties. He recruited experts as second readers, but it was he who was responsible for argumentation, organization, method, and it was he who gave moral support to the students. All of this remains fundamental to HTC. What I'm claiming here is that what HTC became, a pilot program for programs across the United States, was created in this early period, and it was created by Stan. The foundation of Stan's way of doing history and criticism is his training as an architect. I never heard him talk about what inspired him to shift from design to history, but I did see the daily evidence of his belief that design was an intellectual discipline and that architectural intelligence was an excellent foundation for scholarly work. When he chose students for the PhD program, to my amazement, he gave a lot of attention to design portfolios. No matter that people were going to be spending 6 years doing nothing but writing, Stan felt that that in those drawings was a good predictor of success. At a visit with Stan in November, when he could see the outcome of his cancer, he said that what he would miss most were his friends, you. Stan enjoyed good talk, you know. He always pressed guests to stay for another drink, probably you remember that. There were many dinners, and he and Nancy were wonderful hosts. Stan ran HTC as a meeting of friends, staying at MIT late into the evening, talking with groups of students. He was very good with young faculty, taking them into his circle and introducing them around MIT. The best demonstration of his personal generosity, and even more, his sense of fairness, was his behavior to a new faculty chosen by a committee. We're very democratic, big committee. The selection of this person over a candidate that he was certain was best for HTC. And as you know, Stan felt strongly and felt very strongly about everything that had to do with HTC, and especially about faculty selection. But once a decision was made, he welcomed the new colleague, supported him, and took him in as a friend. After serving as head of the department, Stan returned to HTC. By then, the modern architecture was taught by Arindam. Stan figured out a different way to make a contribution and developed new courses to fill holes in the section's offerings for design students and undergraduates. He also began to work with the faculty in building technology. He had always been interested in materials. So now we share him with BT and with a worldwide body of admirers, you who come together tonight.
Hi, I'm Gail Fenske, a student of Stan's from the early 1980s. I could go into great depth, great detail about the exemplary quality of his scholarship. Peter Behrens, Herman Muthesius, Alado Diesta, John Kramer, Alvar Aalto, his masterful works in classics and theory, architecture and tradition, the fiction of function, his wonderful analytical studies of urban form, the plan of Savannah stands out in my mind. But the reason I'm here is to shed some light on Stan's founding and leadership of the program in history, theory, and criticism, or HTC, as I knew it during the early 1980s, my years of study at MIT. It's easy enough for me to recall my favorite lectures of Stan's. His account of Thomas Jefferson's life, thought, work, still stands out in my mind. Many lectures do as well for their distinction, their rigor, their clarity, their insight. But equally important to his students were our one-on-one conversations with Stan. Quite simply, he took an interest in our interests. We chose our subjects of research, and Stan, with his sharp and penetrating critical mind, taught us the methods of scholarship. Equally important, Stan created a strong sense of intellectual community in HTC, along with his colleagues Hank Millen and David Friedman, and a stellar roster of visiting professors, including during my years of study, Kurt Forrester, Francois Chouet, Stuart Rede, and Robert Brugman. PhD Forums featured the day's most interesting and controversial scholars and critics, among them Rainer Banham and Peter Eisenman. Stan and Nancy, known for their generous hospitality, hosted all of us as the conversations continued in their loft at Commercial Wharf in Boston, a space that Stan, the architect, designed as a delightful setting for the exchange of ideas. In support of our studies at MIT, Stan created one of the finest spaces conducive to thought, known as the PhD Room. And to complement our text-oriented scholarly inquiries, he arranged opportunities to see architecture on site firsthand, from Newport to Istanbul. HTC, then, was in large part Stan's creation. At the time, there was simply no other program of study like it in the world. What seemed to matter most to Stan, as he watched his students mature as scholars, was that each one of them developed their own program of research, along with their own sense of direction within our rich and varied field of inquiry. Today, those students' books are noted for their diversity of topics. Joseph Seary on Louis Sullivan and Frank Lloyd Wright, Nancy Stieber on housing in Amsterdam, Danilo Udovicki on the Soviet avant-garde, my own work on skyscrapers, and more broadly within HTC, Mark Jarzembeck on Leon Battista Alberti on German theories of empathy and global architecture, Nasser Rabat on the Citadel of Cairo and Mamluk architecture, Martha Pollack on early modern European cities and their military fortifications, and Hilary Ballin on 17th century Paris and mid-20th century New York. Architectural practice, as Stan viewed it, could also serve as a form of reflection and research. That's evident today in the fine architectural work of his students, Paul Carroll and Peter Bentel. Stan had little interest in following the current fashions or trends, intellectual or architectural. He made his own judgments and assessments. His criterion was excellence. That he was an outstanding teacher has been widely recognized by a number of awards and recognitions. But for his students and colleagues, what counted most was his example. He was a model of scholarly integrity and craft, and above all else, a possessor of an incisive, critical mind. It is difficult to fathom this loss to our discipline and to the very civility of our academic community. Our world is not the same. We will miss you, Stan.
Stanford was my stepfather. As with so many of us here today, Stanford loomed as a major presence in my life. It has dawned on me that reckoning with those many influences and kindnesses will be an unceasing preoccupation of my life moving forward. I was fortunate to have spent time with Stanford during his last 2 weeks, and I was struck by the immediacy and significance of many of the recollections that he shared with his family at that time. What shone through especially was the humility and the depth of feeling as he responded to probes and talked, for instance, about growing up with his parents and his brother, while opening up to experiences that would begin to map out his own life ways. Asked about influences that impelled him at a young age to move towards architecture, he recalled how impressed he was with the construction of a local civic building along the lines of a compelling integration of materials, forms, and purpose. This in turn led to exchanges about Stanford's early schooling, especially the importance of mentors and gentle advocates. Amid his intensifying interest in and orientation towards design and architecture, these well-remembered individuals helped to illuminate opportunity for him. I was touched at how earnestly and humbly Stanford talked about these influences as they related to his early educational and career passages. I feel that it is a very fitting tribute to share these recollections with you, given the many people gathered today for whom and with whom Stanford fostered awareness, perseverance, and opportunity, as well as assisted with real care and selflessness in the choices and engagements that have shaped many careers and lives, bringing opportunity and inspiration where they might not otherwise have flourished so splendidly. Thank you.
Thank you.
A small story with lots of detail. Stan had a thing about checking one's sources. I will tell an unexpected story about this that says something about Stan's generosity and yours too, Nancy, in a context that is deceptively trivial. The background scene is about yours truly trying to reciprocate the hospitality of two wonderful Thanksgivings at Stan and Nancy's. So here goes. I had recently turned 29, must have been close to the end of the spring of 1986 or 1987. Stan mentioned that Nancy and he were in the UK for part of the summer. Excited to show them something of my own world, meaning especially my English, Indian, and Pakistani friends, and also two of my siblings who in the same few weeks happened to be visiting London from Lagos, Nigeria. So I organized for a large group to see a play at the Half Moon Theater. Purposefully, this is not the West End, but a recently completed venue on the fringe scene in London's East End that serves as a minority community venue for Afro-Saxons, as we sometimes call ourselves, Jamaicans, Indians, Pakistanis, and actually working class white Brits. The play I chose was directed by an acquaintance, Albie Jones. Its brief blurb in a poster said something about West Indian immigrant experiences in London. I didn't bother to check the reviews, in part because, fringe theme apart, the theater building itself was a recent work of British Austrian, or maybe British Belgian, architect Florian Bagel. Incidentally, Florian had dissuaded me from coming to the USA, saying that doing architecture was superior to writing about it. I knew Florian from his having once dated Katie Venner, older sister of my, at the time, girlfriend. Katie was also a fundraiser and manager of the Half Moon. A rendezvous at the Half Moon would, in other words, be an opportunity to show Stan what was new and exciting in British architecture, while also giving him a sense of my own personal life, as I hoped also to be exposing him to forms of Black British theater and its social world unfamiliar to most Americans. Stan accepted the invitation and took the opportunity to invite his own local friends, and I remember in particular Roy Landau at the time of the Architectural Association, and also Italian architect and historian Mica Bandini. On the appointed day, disaster struck for me. Suffice it to say that Stan and Nancy did show up, as did Roy and Mika, but that apart from one or two acquaintances in the audience encountered only during an intermission, my friends had not shown up, and neither had my sisters. Apologies only came later in those good old days without cell phones. I had no idea why nobody showed up. Worse, Katie Venner was not at the theater that evening. As if that was not trying enough, the play turned out, if truth be told, to be a little bit embarrassing. Don't get me wrong, it was fun-filled with lots of situational slapstick, a tragic comedy with overdone skits occasionally spoken in Jamaican patois. There was also a lot of singing, occasionally call and response sections inviting the audience in, but also over-repetitious in its main theme. The play had very little serious intellectual content and a theatrical complexity probably aimed at young teenagers. As the evening progressed, I felt like sinking into a hole, rather crestfallen by the obvious disappointment that the event did not match my hopes for something like the avant-gardism, I don't know, of a Pina Bausch performance, for instance. I had dragged Stan and Nancy and Roy and Mika out to East London for a play that did not have much to recommend it, thanks to not checking the references and reviews in Root magazine or Time Out, not to mention that everyone else was a no-show. I was nervous when it was over, and we were deciding what to do for dinner. Scrutinizing my guests, I noticed that Stan, Nancy, and Mika were merrily humming the play's easily memorized musical themes. They were genuinely laughing with the play's humor, and surprisingly, not at it.
Roy was the only one who looked like someone politely hiding his boredom. Stan and Nancy's sincere enjoyment and the fact that Florian Bagel's theater building was alone, really worth the visit anyway, lifted my private anxiety and misery. I don't recall what happened with dinner that evening, but remember that later we walked off to a car and I was offered a ride home to Chelsea, where I lived at the time, or where my folks lived at the time. Nancy, you then mentioned how you had this tradition of driving all over the bridges, crossing the Thames. I remember thinking, huh? Why would anyone do that? The typical jadedness of living in a city for years and years and no longer seeing anything special about it. In any case, I accepted to be dropped off, and so we squeezed into a small car with you, Nancy, at the steering wheel. I recall the car was a Mini Coupe, straight out of the 1960s, and that we started the bridge carousing, perhaps from Tower Bridge. I'll spare you the details, but through it all, we were laughing and singing the ditty from the play. Had you seen us, you'd be forgiven for thinking that the car was a group of tipsy teenagers, no comment on your driving, Nancy, carousing through the streets of London on a Friday night. Only later the next day did it occur to me that Stan and Nancy had been sensitive to my having suffered so many letdowns and that they were being generous by making light of it all, but also teaching that sometimes one just enjoys a performance for what it is, by showing me that they too could be game for that. Stan was, of course, a renowned scholar who often came across as a serious, and sometimes at least for us junior people at the time, even brooding academic. But he was also a joyous, relaxed, witty, fun-loving man, as I learned. And less usually, he was generous as a critic, one willing to open up this, his other side, to those professionally not his peers. And I believe that this is rare. I'm speaking because I've had teachers like Rainer Banham, Robert Maxwell, John Musgrove, Adrian Forty, and Bill Hillier in my days at University College in London. Oh, and did I say how I learned my lesson that fateful day? That checking my sources before putting anything out there was important. Adieu, Stan.
Good afternoon. My name is Adnan Morshed. I came to MIT in 1993 from the other side of the world. My first semester at MIT was rough. I was lonely, missing my family and friends back home. The head of the department was Stanford Anderson. Once in a while, I would run into him in the hallway or at some evening lectures. Like many other new students, my interaction with him limited to rather mundane rituals of hellos and how are yous. He didn't teach a course at the time, so opportunities to know him better were few and far between. Yet in those brief and trivial infinite corridor exchanges, I noticed that Stanford Anderson was gracious, kind, gentle, and endearing. His polite demeanor, his non-judgmental and slightly melancholic gaze, and occasional handshakes made me feel something like this. Oh, this is a cool dude. I was glad that Stan was the head of the department. He, in some inexplicable way, made an international student like me feel at home. I just didn't know how he did it, but he did, and he did it well. Stan, however, didn't know that secretly I was very jealous of something that he had possessed. Can you imagine what it was? His surreally shiny silver hair. In an awkward moment of self-orientalizing pastiche, I told myself, I must have that hair once I grow up, if grow wiser, if ever. I got to know Stan better, really better, by the end of my first semester at MIT, when he called me to his office to say that he was very pleased with my proposal for the Schlossman Research Grant. Ever since, I have been Stan's student, advisee, and later, may I say, friend. He was a guide in the true sense of the word, giving sound intellectual advice and inspiring to do more and better. But there was something truly exceptional, extraordinary about Stan. He was one of those rare teachers, I thought, who could effortlessly mix intellectual, critical guidance with an attitude that I would like to call empathy. It was not pretense to win over advisees. It was who he naturally was. Yes, at times he could have been a bit intimidating, or even crack a dry joke or two that no one had a clue about. But his innate ability to conflate guidance and empathy, rigor and affection made him not just a teacher, but ultimately, I think, a father figure. A father figure is a unique, strange, mysterious, sublime, and beautiful trope. Most archetypal filial quests, Homer's Telemachus looking for his father Odysseus, are often more than longing for a father lost. It is less about a real father than a peculiar yearning for a father figure who is neither a father nor a provider. That figure assures, scolds, directs, guides, writes stern emails, and sometimes lukewarm recommendation letters, and gives grants, hopefully large ones, all without being an actual father. This is the father figure that a doctoral student seeks out when he or she is unsure of a topic or its ongoing direction, yet can show up at his office and easily strike a vague, rambling, nervous conversation. He doesn't mind it, though. He doesn't repeatedly and furtively look at his watch. He listens patiently and eventually provides some much-needed advice as to how to get beyond the roadblock. And I'm talking about Stanford Anderson. He inspired both awe and admiration. He was a worthy, useful, loving canvas onto which we, or many students could project our filial expectations. I have always been proud to call him a teacher and a mentor, and all along I have remained envious of his sublime silver hair. I'm sad that he's gone, but I'm so glad that we could gather today to celebrate the life of this indomitable teacher, a father figure who truly inspired us. My deepest condolences to Nancy and the family. Rest in peace, Stan. We will miss you forever.
Dear Stan, it's me, Meejin, and I miss you. It's hard to walk down the corridors and realize you're not with us anymore. When I come into your office in the mornings now, I'm reminded how you greeted me there about 15 years ago, right around this time of year. I sat uncomfortably in your low alto chair. I think you were supposed to be interviewing me, but instead we had a conversation. Not about me and not about you, but a conversation about architecture that meandered and somehow, if you remember, landed on Maison de Verre. And by the end, I was completely at ease. I left your office a little more at peace and with a little more knowledge and a lot more respect for architecture at MIT because of you, your integrity, your intellectual generosity, and now your legacy. Stan, I'm sitting in your office now, trying to fill your shoes as head of the department, and I'm struck by how special that time was and how incredibly special you were. You were the department's compass and consciousness for so, so many years. You had the long view, the generous view, and you helped many of us find the way, despite the noise, to grow, navigate, and contribute the best of ourselves. You did this by example, and we are so indebted to you. I wonder, do you know how thankful we were and how thankful we will always be? I remember when we caught the corridors on fire or when we flooded the studios, you were always measured in your response. Slow to blame, quick to put things in perspective. You flew far distances to inaugurate our projects, made time to attend our lectures, supported our teaching. You spent long nights reading our papers, theses, and dissertations. You connected architects and architecture scholarship throughout the world. And most importantly, you connected us within these walls to each other. The low alto chairs are gone now, but your ethos is still deep in our corridors and classrooms. Stan, there are so many here today to remember you and those real conversations that formed us and the department. We promise, and I promise, to honor you, to remember to have those real conversations that can change us and will continue to change us.
In the last few weeks, dozens and dozens of emails have circulated about Stan, and among those, I just pick one from John Hubrocken that I would like to close with. When Stan chaired the search committee for the new head of the department, he took the initiative to invite me to meet the committee, and I joined in 1975, which enabled me to grow in a stimulating environment where his presence was a model for intellectual leadership for me. Stan's tenure has shaped the department at MIT in important ways. When he founded the HTC section with Henry Millen, it was the first time that architectural history was to be taught in an architectural school by an architect historian. It established a format of teaching history grounded in professional experience and knowledge. Early during my headship of the department, I was allowed to run a PhD program in architecture. This innovation was the result of a long period of advocacy by Stan. It gave the department an intellectual base not yet known at that time in architectural education. We decided to early on limit the program to HTC-based studies and make sure that the solid standards were set before branching out into other fields of inquiry. Stan's relaxed but focused manner of speaking set the tone in the HTC group and always made it a pleasure to have a conversation with him. He was keenly aware of people's individual or political motivations, but his judgment was always based on merit, which was indeed a pleasure to do business with him. The hospitality of the two of you, and he's addressing Nancy, at your home was left cherished memories, although contact between us has become incidental due to distance and age. Knowing that it can no longer be continued is a real loss and makes me aware more keenly how much I respected him and valued his friendship. I wish you strength, Nancy, to bear his absence, and my thoughts are with you. With that, we conclude this memorial gathering. Thank you all for coming. We now have a reception, which is in McCormick Hall. It's a dormitory, which means that we will have to officially sign in so that we don't get caught wandering around, poking in the messy rooms of all the kids. So I've been asked to, if you don't have an MIT ID, make sure you have your driver's license or some other form of ID. They will want to see that.